Jesus is the real star. I'm just his hype man.
In Your Face Section with Pete Cabrera Jr. Oh, Jesus, baby.
So, guys, here we go. I call this series The Elephant in the Room. This is part one. Now, the reason that it's called The Elephant in the Room is because it's that subject that nobody wants to talk about. It's that subject that we tiptoe around. It's that subject that puts fear in most people. We don't want to feel cornered. We don't want to feel challenged. Maybe we don't know where certain people's beliefs are at. Maybe they have certain doctrines, maybe belief systems. Maybe they believe certain things that will probably cause conflict. And so I don't want to get into the discussion of, you know, this is what I believe. I want to get into the discussion of this is what the word says. And when we can get into what the word says, then that should mold our beliefs, not the other way around. And that's really what it's about. Brian Carter, what's going on? Brian Carter has also a podcast called Christ in You. And these guys are amazing. I told Brian Carter this morning, I sent him a text and I said, you know what, Brian, I'm going to tell you right now, man, after I watched, you know, Christine, you guys' podcast, you gave me the courage, man, to start mine. Because if you guys got committed like that, see, I really didn't want to commit, but I told him that. I talked to him this morning. I texted him and I said, hey, just so you know, bro, I'm going to give it to you. So here it is. And so, guys, here we go. So I am going to just start. Can we just start? Why not? Okay. So, just know that as we go through this topic, as we go through the subject, there's going to be some people on here that are going to be asking questions, and you're going to find out really quick where people are at doctrinally, and that's okay. Okay, that's okay. We want to know where Christ is in everything, right? So the elephant in the room, part one. Before we address the demonic, we have to address what it is and the root at its core. So that's what we're going to do, okay? So let's discuss... let's discuss behavior before we do anything. Let's just discuss that and where it comes from. It's obvious that we teach that a demonic spirit or evil spirit or anything that has to do with what we'd call the kingdom of darkness will influence us to go against God's will, causing us to fall into sin. So the question is, how is this done? How is it that it causes us to fall into sin? And we got to find out the core of it all. And this is what this is about. So before we get into the demonic, we have to find out who we were in the story, okay? So question number one, are we going to be held liable for what we say and what we do by God? That's the first question you got to ask yourself. And does this apply to everyone, saved and unsaved? Yes or no? So the question is, are we all going to be held liable for what we do and what we do? What we do and what we don't do, excuse me. Does everyone have a judgment day per se? Will everyone see the face of God? Will everybody come to that place? That's the question. Are we all held liable for what we do and what we don't do? Now, remember, it's not just, look, sin isn't just what you do. It's also what you don't do. That's James 4:17. For him to do right and does it not, it is sin. So the question is, what is causing us to sin? What is causing us to do these things outside of what it is that we're supposed to do or not do? And that's what I want to address. I want to address the core of what it is, the core of the demonic, the core of an evil spirit, the core of the fall. Like, what is it? Okay. So on a side note, something to think about. What if someone is demonically possessed or is under the power of a demonic spirit? Okay. Let's say that someone's under the power. Is that person held liable by God for their actions while under demonic influence? What I mean by that is, if someone says that I am demonically possessed, I have an evil spirit, will that person be held liable for their actions? Okay, that's the question. Since technically, they would be what we would call demon possessed or under demonic influence. Basically, what we're saying is that this person would say that, you know, I have this power over me and I can't for some reason shake it off. Will I be held liable because I am being controlled or manipulated by a spirit? That's the question. Please explain why. Like, that's the question. Why would that person be held liable? Or why would he not be held liable? That's the question, right? So if you say no, then you have to explain why you think that that person would not be held liable. Here's the other thing. Do people, I don't know where you're at doctrinally, but do people go to hell? That's the question. Okay, so if people go to hell, then the question would be, why do they go? Now, remember, if you are not of Christ and you're living in sin, you're going to be held liable for that. So does this mean that someone who has a demonic spirit or an evil spirit or all these things, are they still held liable by the same judgment as everyone else? That's the question. Okay. That's something to think about. Who does the blame go to? Who gets judged? Does the flesh get condemned? Does the soul get condemned, or the spirit? Because we're spirit, soul, and body. So does it all go together, or is it separated? Like, how's this work? Okay. Here's another question. What's the difference between being possessed and being deceived? That's a good question, right? Because I haven't gotten into the teachings yet. I'm just asking questions, right? Can a Christian be free of evil spirits and demonic powers, filled with the Holy Ghost, and yet live in deception? Can a Christian be deceived even though they're spirit-filled, even though they have the power of God, even though they lay hands on the sick, even though they go around doing good, even though God is using them in a mighty way? Can a Christian be deceived in an area of their life? That's a question to ask, because deception is a powerful thing, right? Now, remember, the scriptures tell us that the enemy came to deceive us. We're going to talk about what the difference is between deception and possession, right? Because we have to talk about what possession is, right? That's the key. Okay, so what if the deception is that they believe that they're possessed by a demonic spirit? Now what happens? What if the Christian who's filled with the Holy Ghost and filled with power is deceived in an area where they believe that they have an evil spirit? What happens now? That's the question, right? Did God say that he would give you an evil spirit? Did God say you could have an evil spirit? Did God say? That's the question, right? Then that becomes true for them. It becomes their reality by merely accepting this as truth, even if it's a lie. What I mean by that is this. Watch this. Let's say you're a Christian and you do not believe that God heals. Does that mean God does not heal, or does that mean that you will not experience that part of God because you've accepted the lie instead of the truth? Okay, let's talk about miracles and manifestations and all the things that we want to walk in as Christians. So if you're deceived in an area and you believe that God doesn't do the things that he used to do in the Bible, does that mean that it's true biblically, or does that just mean that it's true for you? That's the question. So if I, as a Christian, was to believe that I could be demon possessed, now whether it's true or not, it will be true for me. Because the Bible says that as a man believes in his heart, and it also says all things are possible for them who believe, even if you believe wrong. So if you believe wrong, then even those things are possible because you're believing that it's true. So you'll be manifesting a lie, and we call that deception, right? That's a good question, right? In terms of possession, right? Okay, so what's the difference between a non-believer and a demon-possessed person? That's a good question. So a non-believer is someone who's not born again, and someone who's demon-possessed is someone that's possessed by what? A spirit, a demon. What is possession? That means owned, right? Okay, that's a question. In terms of possession, it's about manifesting a lie, because that's what it's about. Because our entire life is about manifestation. It's just a matter of what spirit you're going to manifest. Now, remember, we have two spirits, and I'm going to talk about this as we go on with the podcast, okay? You have the spirit of error and the spirit of truth. These are two spirits, and we're going to talk about them as we keep going. And we're going to talk about the core of this, because once we get into what we would call spiritual warfare, we need to know what our foundation is. I tell people this: look, before you swing, make sure that you have a good stance. And that's not even as important as what it is you're swinging at, right? Because you got to know what it is you're trying to hit. And we as Christians, sometimes we don't know what it is we're hitting. We don't know what it is that's attacking us. We don't know what it is. We just put a spirit on everything, and we swing all day long, and we get exhausted. And sometimes, You know, I tell people, look, the world will throw curves at you. And the only answer to a curveball is learning to hit a curveball. So I get thrown curves all day long, scripture-wise. And the enemy is going to throw curves at you all day long, scripture-wise. And so this is why we as a body need to come together, right? So here we go. Excuse me. What does a non-believer manifest on a daily? Excuse me. What does a non-believer manifest on a daily? He's a non-believer. So let's talk about the root of this non-believer. If this non-believer does not believe, that means he's living a lie. John 14, 6. Remember, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, which means that I tell people this all the time. You don't even have a life till you come to Jesus. I'm sorry, because the Bible says that your life is hidden in Christ, which means you don't even have a life until you come to Christ, because spiritually you're dead. So if you're spiritually dead, what are you manifesting all day long? You're not manifesting life. Now, you may move your limbs, you may walk around, you may talk and be happy, but deep down inside, you don't have life itself, who is the Christ. So the definition of possession is to be owned or controlled by someone or something. A slave is doing things against their will. They have no freedom to do anything outside of what their master tells them to do. The people who are not born again are slaves to sin, or are they slaves to demonic forces, evil spirits? And what's the difference, to be honest, right? What's the difference? Romans 6:12 says this, okay? For when you were slaves to sin, you were free in regards of righteousness, which means we were all slaves to sin, according to Romans chapter 6, verse 20. We're the children of Israel. Now, here's a question that I like to ask all the time, because it's kind of one of them curveballs. We're the children of Israel as slaves to Pharaoh. As slaves. Now, we're talking about the children of Israel before Moses came. They were building bricks, or making, you know, the kingdom of Pharaoh with bricks for 400 years. They were slaves. Pharaoh owned them. Can we all agree that? Nobody would disagree that, because Pharaoh was their master. Okay. Were they demon-possessed? Now, here's where your brain's going to feel like it's just smashing against the wall, right? Because of the doctrine we've been taught. Because we think possession is something that happens in the spirit, usually. But hear me out. The children of God were children of God, which means that they were the seed of God, which means this. Jacob wrestled with God, and Jacob said, I won't let you go till you bless me. And God called Jacob Israel, my firstborn son. So all of them were the seed of Abraham. Now watch this. The seed of Abraham, they have the seed of God because they're the seed of Abraham. They're in Egypt as slaves. They're possessed physically, because it had to be purchased. This is what the Passover lamb's all about. They could not leave because they were a slave. So the question is, once again, were they demon possessed? Did the gods of Egypt, watch this, did the gods of Egypt live in the children of God? They were worshiping false gods, guys. Remember, the 10 plagues represents the 10 gods, the Nile god, right? The Nile god, Napi. You have frog god, the lice god. You have the cattle, which is economy. You have the sky. You have, you know, the fertility is the frog god. These are gods. The light, Ra, right? Like, these are gods that are lies. They're the false gods of Egypt, which means that they weren't real. God was showing that they were all lies. So did these spirits that, because let's get to the nitty gritty here. Did these false gods spiritually possess the children of God who did not have the Holy Ghost living on the inside of them? Were they spiritually possessed? That's a good question. We know they were physically possessed. We know that physically they couldn't do whatever they wanted. And we know that they were sold as slaves. And did you guys know that that represents us before the born again experience? Because Jesus is the Passover lamb that sets us free from bondage. But we have to address what this spirit is that we're trying to address, because we're talking about the elephant in the room, the demonic. We're talking about biblical deliverance, like what it means to be delivered biblically. Because biblically, if I was to, like with the circles that I'm around, if we'd have been in Egypt in those days, they would have been talking about, well, the reason that they can't leave is because there's this spirit over Egypt who has this power over Pharaoh and all these gods. And it's this demonic territory that's just taking over the people of God, and it's in them and on them and around them. But one guy shows up with a stick, and his name is Moses. One guy shows up with a stick and doesn't even address the spiritual atmosphere, doesn't even address the demonic. He's addressing Pharaoh, and he's telling Pharaoh, let my people go, because he knows where the physical bondage is. He knows where the bondage is coming from. The bondage is coming from a man who doesn't know who he is, who's trying to overthrow everything that God is doing through his people. So am I saying there's any demonic forces? I'm going to get to this. I'm just addressing, were the people of God in Egypt possessed? Everybody would have to say yes, because that's what a slave is. A slave. Okay. Now watch this. Did the spirits enter them? They worshiped them. The people of God worshiped the gods of Egypt. Were they demon possessed? Were they influenced by these devils and demons? Very interesting question. Watch this. What is sin? And what is the evil spirit? Are they the same? These are questions I like to talk about. Question number two. What is the determining factor that causes us to behave a certain way? What makes a sin? Is it a spirit, a nature? What's the difference? Right, that's a question we should be asking ourselves. Let's talk about obedience and disobedience. Can we do that? Okay. Here's where it gets exciting. Okay. Because we have to talk about Genesis 2, 16 through 17. Okay. God commanded the man. Watch this. Genesis 2, 16 through 17 says this. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat. I have to stop right here, because I have to address this. When we start talking about the free will thing, I love this verse, because I run into a lot of Christians who tell me God gave us free will. And I said, well, what does free will mean? It means you can freely do something. Well, this verse contradicts that, because it says that God commanded the man, saying, you may freely eat, which means that he couldn't freely eat without a command. Therefore, that's not free will. That's a command that he can do something. So the command came that said he could freely eat. That's a command. That's command number one. The first command that God gave man was to freely eat. He couldn't eat without the command. Okay, watch this. Command number two. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat. Those are two commands. One is freely eat. One is don't eat. That's not free will. Those are commands. Eat, don't eat. In fact, I believe that God gave us 10 commandments, not 10 suggestions. They're commands. Hey, a king gives a command, right? So here we go. But of the tree of the knowledge, let me start there again. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat thereof, you shall surely die. Now, Romans 8, 6 confirms that to be carnally minded is death. So we're to confirm that Adam was not supposed to die. He wasn't supposed to die. He was supposed to live forever. But because he ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the consequence was you will surely die. Okay, so I'm going to get into a question here that's going to probably shake some feathers, and I think it should shake some feathers, because we should really be thinking about this. Now, we have people that say certain things, and I'm not trying to poke the bear. I'm just trying to ask a question here. We have groups, right? We have groups that believe certain things, and this is why we have to go to scriptures, right? Like, I have a good friend of mine I love so much. We have this discussion about, you know, can a Christian sin? You know, because it says that, you know, if the seed is in him, he cannot sin. And so we talk about that. And, you know, I'm like this. I have, like, just me and myself. I read this scripture right here. Like, can a Christian sin? Okay, let me ask you this. Did Adam have sin in him before the fall? Was sin in him? Did God create Adam with sin in him? That's the question. Adam had no blood in him, according to scriptures. The body was alive to God, not to sin. Okay, this is important, okay? Because according to Romans 8, verse 6, it says this. It says, to be carnally minded is death, which means that Adam fell because Adam died when he became carnally minded. Because it says, to be carnally minded is death, which means that Adam died the minute he became earthly minded. And I'm going to talk about this later on. I think it's in James. I think it's in James 4:17, where it talks about that the earthly mind is demonic. Earthly mind is demonic, which means if you have a mind that thinks earthly, right off the bat, you become demonic, just thinking that way, okay? So give this some thought. So we know that he died, death entered the minute he became carnally minded, because to be carnally minded is death. So when I ask people, can somebody define death biblically to me? And you have to use this verse, because it says to be carnally minded is death. So that's what death is, to be carnally minded. So how did Adam and Eve die? They became carnally minded, which means they now began to think carnally. And we're going to talk about this in Genesis chapter 6, right? When God talks about what that is. But I won't even hit that yet. I'm just going to keep going because I got to get on this. So now, why is it important if Adam had sin or not before the fall? This is very vital, because there's scriptures that give us clues. And I want to talk about this. Yes, James 3:15. Thank you. Thank you for correcting me there. Bow. Genesis 2:23 says this. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. So why is this so vital? Because if you read the biblical text, it says that she's now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. There's no blood in this. And this is important, because the scriptures tell us, here's what it says. The scriptures tell us that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. That's what it says. But here he says bone and flesh. So what's the difference between this flesh and the fallen flesh? And I'm going to show it to you. It's right here in Luke 24:39. Behold my hands. This is after Jesus' resurrection. Behold my hands, my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit has not flesh and bone like I have. Now you're asking, why is this so vital? How does this prove that Adam didn't have any blood? Because Jesus shed his blood for humanity, which means that when he was on the cross, he bled to death, which means that his blood was shed for the sins of humanity. When he resurrected, there's no more blood in him. Why is that important? And I'm going to talk about this, because according to Leviticus 17:11, it says, for the life of the flesh is in the blood. Why is this important? Because Genesis chapter 6 confirms that man is also flesh, which means that after the fall, the flesh was alive to sin, because blood was now needed to be shed. Now, we know that blood doesn't enter until the first birth, which is Cain and Abel. There has to be a shedding of blood. Now, we know that all flesh has to be redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, which means that when a woman gives birth, and this is why a woman has a menstrual cycle. I have to watch how I say this, but I'm saying this because the context is blood. When a woman is going to give birth, she has a menstrual cycle every month. That's a shedding of blood because she's preparing her body to give birth to flesh. All flesh has to be redeemed. All flesh has to be born again through the shedding of blood. So why is this vital? Because Adam, before the fall, didn't have any blood in him because Jesus is the second Adam, which means that before he could go to glory, he had to be in the exact same position of the first Adam before the fall, which means there was no blood present. Why is this important? Because this proves that Adam didn't have any sin in him, but yet he sinned, which means this, that if Adam can sin when there's no sin in him, then we can all fall to sin because of that. That's very, very vital. Because how did Adam fall if there was no sin in him? And that's the key to what it is we all battle in Christianity. Adam was not a sinner by nature, guys. Yet he committed sin. How is that possible? Because we're going to talk about what sin is before we can talk about what an evil spirit is and a demon is, because we have to address it. As Christians, we got to know what it is we're battling here, right? So did sin enter Adam at the fall, or did Adam enter death? That's a good question. Did anything enter Adam biblically? Do we hear about anything entering Adam? Okay, here we go. Seems they were held liable for listening to the wrong advice or someone else's opinion, at that matter, about what God actually said. Because you're going to find out that the serpent says something. Genesis 3:17. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of your wife. This is interesting because Adam wasn't even listening to the serpent. Adam was listening to his wife. Wait. The serpent didn't even speak to Adam. The lie went from the serpent to Eve, from Eve's lips to Adam, which means that the lie came through another person who was deceived, which means that the deception can keep going, which means that if you're deceived and you don't believe something and you speak, you are now causing deception in the ears of others. This is why it's vital that we use the word of God. Did God say? Watch this. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of your wife, and have eaten from the tree of which I commanded thee. He commanded him, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for your sake. Let me stop here for a second. Watch this. The Bible says that man was not cursed here. It says that the ground was cursed for his sake. Now watch this. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it. So the ground is cursed, and you're going to eat of the ground. You're not going to eat the ground. You're going to eat of the ground all the days of your life. That's the curse. And that's not the only thing that happens with the curse. This was not the serpent speaking through Eve. It was the lie handed down by her, by the serpent. It was the lie handed down to her. So she took the lie as truth and spoke it. So the lie caused death. This is what this is about. Here we go. So what did the serpent actually do? What did it do? Well, let's read about it. That's in Genesis 3:14. Here we go. And the Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this. Okay, what did he do? Let's stop. What did he do? Did he slap Eve? Did he grab her by the throat? Did he punk her? Did he manipulate her? What did he do? Actually, he said, did God say? That's what he did. He questioned God. That's what he did. Because you did this. What did he do? You questioned me. You told him something I didn't say. Man, how many Christians you know like that? This is vital. Thou art cursed above all the cattle and above every beast. Hey, guys. Every time you say something that God did not say, there's going to be a curse behind that. Because you are not to say anything besides what God says. I love when Nathan Cintron, we were having breakfast the other day, and he asked me something. And I said, well, this is what I think, right? he was asking me about a certain thing, and he was asking me about, you know, what do you think about drinking? And I said, well, me myself, you know, I don't drink, but if they want to, I mean, that's between them and, you know, but that's me. And then he said this, he said, but you're in the office. You don't get to speak for you. You speak for God because you're a minister, and ministers only say what God says. And I was like, oh yeah, you're right, bro. You're right. So yeah, I have to say what God says, because Jesus said, I only do what he does and say what he says. Ugh. Yeah, I know that one stung, right? But don't worry. I'm not one of these guys that goes around drinking. I don't drink, guys. Don't worry about that. I'm not a drinker. Here we go. I was in the past. And the Lord said unto the serpent, Genesis 3:14, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all the cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon your belly you shall go. Watch this. And dust shall you eat all the days of the life, all the days of your life. So the curse to Adam was, you're going to eat from the dust, but the serpent's actually going to eat dust. Okay, let's talk about why the dust was cursed. Well, we know in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, that man was made from the dirt. And I'm going to talk about that here in a little bit, but let me keep going. What did the serpent do? He lied and deceived Eve, making her believe opposite of what God said. Hey, Apostle Paul hits this. He says in 2 Corinthians 11:31, he says, but I fear lest by any means as the serpent beguiled Eve with his subtleties, which means beguiled means deceived, means tricked. So your minds, here it is, so your mind should not be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ, which means that you can have a corrupt mind filled with the Holy Ghost, filled with power, filled with everything that God has given you. You can have your mind corrupted to the lies of the enemy. We got to get to that. Watch this. Paul said that your mind could be corrupted. What are the enemy's tactics? To lie to you, to get you to believe something that God did not say. That's what it's all about. Did you know that the man was not cursed? Only the serpent was cursed at the fall? Because God can't curse what he blessed. He blessed man. He said it is good. Right? That's what it said. What is the curse? And how did it enter humanity? Hey, check this out. This curse came through God. God gave it to the serpent. The serpent didn't create a curse. Did you guys know that? It didn't come through the spirit. It came through disobedience to God's command. God gave the curse. God said, hey, check this out. I got a curse to give to you. Sometimes we walk around like people are cursing us. Like, do you know where that curse came from? The curse came from God. God cursed. He cursed something, right? But now we don't curse. Now we bless, right? We're going to talk about this as we go on. Genesis 3:14, and the Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all the cattle, above every beast of the field. Upon your belly you shall go, eating dust all the days of your life. Dust is dirt. Okay? Dust is dirt. Watch this. Why is the curse to eat dirt? Huh, guys? Why is the curse to eat dirt? When we listen to the lie, we get eaten by the effects of sin. Did you guys know that we, and I'm going to show this to you, we come from the dirt. We give the enemy permission to bite us. Once we get into the flesh, it's over. Watch this. So the curse was put on the serpent by God. So the serpent doesn't have a choice. It was a consequence given to the serpent by God. It's what the serpent does. It eats dirt. That's what it does. Can we agree? Watch this. You know, in Numbers 21:6-9, we hear about the children of God that are in the desert and they start complaining. And then God sends fiery serpents and they start biting people and they start dying. And did you know complaining is a really bad idea when you're in the presence of God? You're not to complain. And he sent snakes to bite them because that's what snakes do. They bite flesh. Now, then they made this thing called a bronze snake and they put it on a stick and they held it up and they said it was in the likeness of a snake. Excuse me. It wasn't a snake, but it looked like a snake. Okay, that's very vital. You got to know this. I'm going to show you why. Genesis 2:7, and the Lord God formed the man of the dust of the ground. Okay, so we were formed from the dust of the ground. And he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. So man is made of dirt. What does the serpent eat? And Genesis 3:19 confirms, in the sweat of your face shalt thou eat bread till thou return into the ground. For out of it you were taken, from the dust you are, and into the dust shall you return. Which means that, hey guys, let's not talk about drinking on here. This is what this is about. You can do that on a side thing, okay? Get into the teaching. You're allowing your mind to go into something that has nothing to do with what I'm talking about. And that's what we're going to focus on, right, guys? You guys can talk about that later, right? Let's use the comments for what we're addressing. You guys can talk about that later on, okay? Let's stick to the teaching because we only have so much time, and writing all that stuff in the message is really taken away from the message itself. And I'm putting this time into you guys so you guys can understand what's going on. It's okay, guys, really. I just want to make sure that you're getting what I'm saying, because we're putting a lot of work into this as a body to make sure that we all move forward the same direction, all of us together, right? Let's not get stuck on a side note, okay? So here we go. We came from the dirt. The serpent eats flesh. What are we commanded not to live in? Oh, you're good, guys. You're good. I love you guys, man. I just want to make sure that we stay focused here. What are we commanded not to live in? We're commanded not to live in the flesh. Now, remember that the serpent that was made out of bronze, that wasn't an actual serpent. It was in the likeness of a serpent. This is powerful because Jesus came in the likeness of sinful flesh. It doesn't mean that Jesus was sinful. It just means that his body looked like sinful flesh. In the same way that the serpent was formed and put on a stick, which means it looked like a serpent, but it wasn't a serpent. Just like Jesus looked like sin, but he wasn't sin. They held him up. That serpent represents the Christ that's held up on a cross, because Jesus becomes something that you were. And you had the nature of a serpent. Your entire identity was to devour other people, because you were living in sin. Man was to live forever before the fall. He would never return to the dust if he wouldn't have ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Man was a partaker of death through the fall. Man became one with sin. Death had power over him. The wages of sin is death. We live in sin. What is sin? Disobedience to God's word, command? Like, what is it? Hebrews 2:14 says something. Well, let's go to Romans 6:6 first. Watch this. Romans 6:6, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him. Here's the key. That the body of sin might be destroyed. Let me stop there. The body of sin. Does sin have a body, or is sin the body? Before the born again experience. Let me hit that. Watch this. Does sin have a body, or is sin the body before the born again experience? Give that some thought. Let me read it again. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. Does sin have a body, or is sin the body? Therefore, we have to die to our flesh. That's a crazy thought. Is the old man sin by nature? Or does he have sin? Is the old man have sin, or is he sin? Why does the old man have to die? Why couldn't we just get sin out of him? You couldn't get sin out of the old man. The old man was sin by nature. He had to die. There was no getting sin out of him. He had to die. There was no fixing him. There was only destroying him. Jesus didn't come to fix you. He came to kill you so you could have a new life. That's what the gospel is all about. The flesh became disobedient to God by nature. This is why the law was given. It's a yoke that controls your flesh. Here's where it's going to get tricky. Hebrews 2:14. You ready? Watch this. Hebrews 2:14. For so much, and this, guys, you gotta really pay attention to this. Watch this. For so much, then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood. That word partakers means that you become one with. So he's talking about the children that are partakers of flesh and blood. People who are born in the flesh. People who are one with the flesh and blood. For so much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood. He also himself, this is Jesus, took part of the same. So Jesus was also a partaker of flesh and blood, obviously, or he wouldn't have been able to shed his blood, or his body wouldn't have been able to get whipped. So we know that he had flesh and he had blood. Watch this. That through death, he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. Jesus was destroying an identity through death. Flesh and blood, that sounds like a body to me. Hey, doesn't the Bible say, according to 1 Corinthians 15:50, doesn't it say that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God? Is that what it says? Flesh and blood cannot inherit it? No, because it's an inheritance. Remember, the fall, you inherited sin in flesh and blood. This is why blood is required. Blood is the life of the flesh. Flesh and blood will not inherit the kingdom of God. Why is that? The old man lives in the body of sin. So then what does the new man live in? The scriptures call this the body of Christ. We are partakers of the body of Christ now. We are not partakers of flesh and blood because we become one with Christ in the spirit. And we're going to talk about that. Jesus partook with our body, according to Hebrews 2:14. He became what we were so we could raise a newness of life and become as he is in this world. That's what it's about. Watch this. According to Luke 24:39, Jesus confirms that spirit does not have flesh and bone like he has, which means that there's no blood, and the flesh now that he has is dead of sin because there's no life in it. Worldly life is now powered by the life of the Holy Spirit, which animates the body that does not have blood, according to that understanding. The effect of sin had to be put on him because it wasn't in him. Jesus became sin for us by being born as a man and dying on the cross and becoming a sin offering for us. He became a sin offering for us. You're asking yourself, what does this have to do with the demonic? What does this have to do with evil spirits? I'm going to show you what this has to do with it. I'm going to show you why we struggle with the demonic, because we don't understand what it is that I'm talking about right now. Watch this. Here we go. By his stripes, you were healed. The effects of sin were put on him. Jesus was without sin, yet the effects of sin were unavoidable. He was not sinful, but the effects of sin were unavoidable. Watch this. It's the same with us. Sin is unavoidable. The effects of sin is unavoidable. You're going to be disrespected. You're going to be persecuted. You're going to be beat on, killed. All these things are going to happen because these are the effects of sin. They don't live in you. Remember, you don't partake of sin anymore. You partake with the body of Christ. This is important. Romans 8:3. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh. What was weak through the flesh? The law was weak through the flesh because the body didn't want to listen to the law. The body didn't want to do what the law said. The body itself has an evil inclination. I'm going to show it to you. It's called a desire. And desire is not a bad thing. This is why we have to know the knowledge of good and evil. Because the desire is not a bad thing. You just have to know whether it's a good desire or a bad one. Which means this. The body doesn't know if it's good or evil, but you do. That's what it's about. You have to know. You have to harness that power of the knowledge of good and evil. You know, the scriptures tell us that we were made in his image and in his likeness, according to the scriptures. You know what that means? That means his image is, when they see us, his likeness is the character. Watch this. Did you know that the scriptures tell us that after Adam had eaten from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, God said, now they'll be like us. They've become like us, knowing good and evil, which means that you weren't like God until you knew the knowledge of good and evil. This is what a God does. A God can distinguish what's good and what's evil. When you can distinguish good and evil, you can harness power. That's what it's about. Because when you can distinguish the difference between what is right and what is wrong, this is when you can be used the right way. Now, for those who don't know right and wrong, they're called animals. They're called beasts. And I think that's what we were. We had the nature of the beast, the nature of the fallen man, the number 666, which is the number of a man, which is the number of a beast. You were a beast. That's why you wore a yoke, and it was called the law, to control some things that you couldn't control, because you were a slave to sin. You were a slave to the fallen nature. You were a slave to the body of sin. Watch this. For what the law could not do, and that it was weak through the flesh, which means it could not control you, couldn't do it, God sent in his son in the likeness of sinful flesh. Ooh. Which means that he sent the law, watch this, God sent the law to control that flesh, but it couldn't do it. So God sent Jesus so he could change your nature by killing you, so it wouldn't conflict or have enmity against who God is for you, because he destroys the very nature and the carnality and the thing that's fighting everything that God is in your walk. And now we're led by the Spirit through Christ. And it says, and for sin, condemning sin in the flesh, which means that he condemned what was causing the law from not being effective in your life, which was stubbornness, which was fighting, kicking against it, always just having this enmity between God and Jesus. Said, all right, I'll go down there and kill that thing. That way it can't get in the way of what your will is in their life, because they have something that's causing them to stray, causing them to live in sin. We're going to talk about this. Here we go. In the likeness of sinful flesh, this is Jesus being born into the world in a body that had no sin in it. Jesus was led to the, check this out, Jesus was held to the decree of a fallen man, which means that the decree of the law was put on Jesus. This is crazy, because I always ask people, Did God call Jesus a sinner, or did the law call Jesus a sinner? Give that some thought. Because he was born under the law, and under the law, not one man is righteous. And I don't know if you know this or not, but Jesus came as a man, and the law looked at him and said, nope, not one is righteous under the law, which means the decree landed on him. That's why he became sin for us, because of that. And he paid the price of sin, because it needed a life. This is crazy thoughts, right? Here we go. So he was held to the decree of the fallen man to the letter. The Son of Man is born in sin. Yet Jesus was not born of sin. He just looked like everyone else on the outside, yet without sin. He was born into sin, into a fallen world of sin, into the law, into all the things that sin had. But he didn't have it in him. He was born from above. His seed was of God, not of man. When the body of Jesus died, sin died with it. That's a crazy thought. Give that some thought. Here we go. Sinful flesh could not walk out the law. Jesus was not sinful flesh. This is why Jesus could fulfill all righteousness, which means that he didn't have that desire to go against God. He had the desire to fulfill the will of God. But yet the flesh had, hear me out, it had desires. It got hungry. He even said, I thirst. He even told his disciples, you have any food? After he resurrected. Check this out. Now, when I say that when Jesus died, sin died with it, that's for you. Not for everybody else. just for you, if you're in Christ, if you're in Christ, right? So here we go. Sinful flesh has problems obeying and listening to God and his commandments. It always has. Why am I saying this to you? Give this some thought. Let's talk about Cain's issue. Galatians 2:20. He said, I'm crucified with Christ. Thank you, Eternal Tunes. I am crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. In the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who died, who loved me and died for me and gave himself for me. It's no longer I. Who's the I in that story? Cain's issue. Let's talk about Cain's issue. Let's talk about Genesis 4:7. Let's get dirty here. Let's get into dirt, right? Here's what God tells Cain. We're going to address this. Genesis 4:7. If you do well, shalt thou not be accepted? And if you don't do well, sin lies at the door. And unto thee shall be his desires, and thou shalt rule over him. Okay, watch this. This happens because they're both sacrificing. Cain and Abel sacrificing to God. Okay. But Cain's sacrifice is not accepted because Jesus says that sacrifice is not what he wants. He wants obedience because he says obedience is better than sacrifice. So guess what he's telling Cain? He's telling Cain, I don't want your sacrifice. I want your obedience. How do we know that? If you do well, you'll be accepted. Do well. That's what I want. I want you to do well. If you don't do well, sin lies at the door. But here's the powerful part of the message. It tells him that he can master it, that he can rule over it, that he can rule over sin, that he can master sin. Wait. This is Cain who's not born again. And God tells him that. God was addressing his actions. If you do good, if you don't do good, that's good and evil, right? Watch this. Seems God said to Cain that even though sin was in Cain, he could still do good. What? God wanted Cain's obedience, not his sacrifice. Yes, folks, even though he was of the evil one, God said to Cain that he could still resist it. And here it is, even rule over it. What? Okay. What is he ruling over? Watch this. 1 John 3:12. Not as Cain, who was of the wicked one, and slew his brother, and therefore slew him, because his own works were evil and his brother's righteous. According to Luke chapter 11, 50 and 51, we find out that Abel is the first prophet. It says that the blood was spilled from all the prophets from Zacharias to Abel, which means that Abel was a prophet, which means a prophet intercedes for the people. And Abel also in scripture says that he was sacrificing the lamb, which means that God was already talking. Look, God talks to his prophets and his prophets speak to the people and tell them, hey, get right. And the Bible tells us that Cain and Abel were in the field, which means that Abel was talking to Cain, talking about, hey, get right. And what happened? Cain said, you're going to die, and ended up killing him. Which is a crazy thought. That's a crazy thought. So let me ask you something. His works. We're going to address this. Cain's works. It says that Cain is of the wicked one. Hey, did you know that Cain and Abel were twins? If you read the scriptures. Because it says that Adam knew Eve. And they conceived. And had Cain. And then Abel. And then another time it says he knew her again. So he knew her twice, but they had three kids, which was Seth. That means that the first two were twins, Cain and Abel, because the scripture says he knew her, then they had Cain, and then Abel, and then he knew her again and had Seth, which means that that's three kids, and he knew her, meaning been intimate twice, which means Cain and Abel were twins, which makes a lot of sense because Esau and Jacob were twins as well. And this, the story folds. And remember Adam and second Adam brothers. But anyways, that's a whole nother conversation. But the reason that I'm addressing this is because we're going to talk about the Behor. But before I do, because we have to find out what devils demons and evil spirits are. Where are they coming from? Where do they come from biblically? Because so far, what I've been talking about so far is what it is that we struggle with on a daily. This is just the struggle that we struggle with. My question is, where's the demonic fit into all this? Like, why are we talking about spirits and demons and this and that? And we're going to talk about what Jesus was doing. He's casting out devils because things are coming out, right? And I'm going to address that because we have to. But before we do, we have to address what happened to you. So you have to know where you're at in the story. In the story, in the new covenant, where are you? And what are you sealed with? And can a spirit enter you? And how does it affect you? I'm just talking about Cain right now. Cain, the Bible doesn't say that anything was in Cain. In fact, Cain's the one that gets cursed. Cain doesn't even say what Adam said. Adam said the serpent, right? The serpent. Eve said the serpent. They were blaming somebody. Cain didn't blame anybody. Cain just straight up lied to God's face. God said, hey, where's your brother at? And Cain was like, I don't know. What, am I my brother's keeper? Cain is the first man in Bible, in scripture, the first person that blatantly looks at God in his face and lies to him. I don't know. He's a father of lies. Cain was lying. He looked right at God's face. Adam didn't even lie. Adam hid, and he was being honest. He's like, hey, you know, what happened? Oh, I hid because I heard your voice and I was naked and I was afraid. He'd been honest. And God told him, hey, did you eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil that I commanded you not to eat from? Cain just straight up, I don't know what you're talking about. What? That is not of God. We're going to address that. Where's that coming from? Was Cain demon possessed? Did Cain have an evil spirit according to scripture? Because seems here that what was in him stayed in him. And God didn't get it out of him. In fact, he marks Cain so nobody will kill him. What's that about? What is that about? Okay, here's a crazy thought. Watch this. What's going on, Rolando? What's up, brother? Watch this. Let's talk about this. Okay. Genesis 8:21 says this. Okay. But before we do that, let's talk about this. Whose works were evil, according to 1 John 3:12. Not as Cain, who's a wicked one, who slew his brother and therefore slew him because his own works were evil. His works, where did his works come from? This is Cain. Whose works? His own works. Accountability for his actions. Whose fault was it? The serpent's fault? An evil spirit? A demon? A devil? Whose fault was it that Cain killed Abel? Let's address what God said was in Cain. It is sin, and it was in his heart because he told him that you could rule over it. You could rule over sin. Sin's the reason you killed him. Sin's the reason. Not a demonic spirit, not the serpent, not the fallen angels, not this demonic darkness. It's in you. Why? Because he told him you could master that thing. You could master it. Don't listen to it. Just do what I say. But he wouldn't listen. Once again, he told Adam, just do what I said. And he didn't. He was tricked. He told Eve, don't eat. And she still did. And once again, they fell. Now here's Cain, not doing what God said. So where's this evil at that needs to be delivered from Cain? Let's find it. Here it is. Genesis 8:21. And the Lord smelled a sweet savor, and the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground anymore for man's sake. For the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I again smite anymore every living thing as I have done. So where does evil live?